First of all, let me say good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
My name's Gene Waltz. I'm with Incinerator RX. I've had the opportunity to work both for and with many of you, and it's good to be back to see everybody. I think we all know why we're here. You know, the EPA back in March 2011 promulgated a new set of emission standards and limits for sewage sludge incinerators. These new rules were triggered by EPA having determined, or we should say maybe redefining, that the residual solids from municipal wastewater treatment plants was a solid and not a liquid waste. And what we are now, our furnaces were classified as solid waste incinerators. And by virtue of that, we're subject now to the Section 129 of the Clean Air Act that has these provisions for maximum available control technology standards. And you all are pretty familiar with this because what the new requirements are, because you've been busy since March of this year trying to comply with the new rules. They included four major new elements, new pollutant emission limits on nine pollutants that had to be determined by annual compliance testing. It included filterable particulate matter, the metals of cadmium, lead, and mercury, the acid gases, sulfur dioxide, and hydrogen chloride, emissions of NOx, carbon monoxide, and also dioxin furans. Also included in that was a new limit on the visible emissions from your ash handling systems. Then, as you've all probably been dealing with in routine operations, the new rules required us to maintain these operating parameter limits on the furnace and scrubber as established by your lowest minimum averages during compliance tests, annual air pollution control equipment inspections. And then why we're all here this morning, the rule also required that stipulated that each facility had to have a certified operator at the facility at all times or within an hour's time of the facility. To become a certified operator, the individual had to go through a training program that covered, to the extent possible, these 10 topical areas. The rule also required that a technical reference document covering these same topics be prepared, which we've done with you. Then in this case, here at the Hampton Roads, we've had these overview sessions to kind of briefly review the same material. And then for your travel and time convenience, thank you guys collectively, and it worked out well that after these sessions over today, you would immediately take the certification test. And so what we're gonna do, and I know some of you have been around these furnaces for many years, to be loyal to what the rule requires, we're still gonna cover some of the basic equipment and operational fundamentals of the Malbar furnace. Then we'll have a second part where we'll go through some of the operational approaches and objectives. It's generally been taking about an hour or so. We'll have maybe a break in between the two parts. And then at the end, we have a little 25-question practice quiz as a warm-up before you actually take the certification test. So we're going to cover some of these topics, and I think if you've read the reference document, you're pretty familiar with all of them. Always first like to talk about and remind ourselves that our process, even though the regulation is not always friendly about it, takes time. It's, even though we're labeled as incinerators, as you all know, we're first running a dryer to dry the water out and then combust the volatile solids. And depending on the furnace size, it's going to be 2 to 3 hours. And our purpose is the volume reduction, evaporate the water, combust the volatile solids, and render the ash to a sterile, inert ash that can be properly landfilled. The Malbar furnace, you know, has been around for over 75 years. It was originally, they were built to roast mineral ores and rocks and then adapted to sludge disposal later. It's referred to as a counterflow device where we're bringing the material in through the top, raveling it down through the furnace and bringing air and fuel in to supplement the process. These furnaces are still being built, but for mostly industrial applications. I'm not aware of anybody now that's building a new malt hearth given the new regulations. For example, the largest furnaces I know that just recently were built in Coushatta, Louisiana a few years ago by ADA Environmental. They're 15 hearths tall, 25 foot 9 in diameter, and what they're doing is putting lignite coal in the top, and they got 1600 degrees from top to bottom, starved air, steam injection, and what's coming out the bottom is activated carbon that they're selling to power plants for mercury removal. So in an interesting twist here, these furnaces are help solving another environmental problem. Just for general purposes, I think most of you are familiar with your different plants. Just briefly, we'd like to go over the configuration at each one. I think we've got four of your five plants represented here today. I think only Chesapeake Elizabeth, the only one, and those operators went through the program earlier this week. Army base, 6R, 22 foot, 3 diameter, with a common Venturi impingement type scrubber. This is pretty common among the industry. Here at Boat Harbor, an 8R 22-3, which is a pretty popular size furnace as well. It has a single Venturi with a packed bed impingement tray scrubber, followed by a multi-Venturi so-called ring jet scrubber made by Vonro. Chesapeake Elizabeth, 7-hearth, 18-9, a little smaller in diameter, again with a common Venturi impingement tray type scrubber. Over at VIP and Riley's house, and got a single Venturi, then impingement tray scrubbers, and because of the SO2 emissions at the VIP plant, they've now installed a packed bed tower, I think of stainless steel media, and a caustic recirculation tank to try to help keep the SO2 down. Williamsburg, 9-hearth, 18 foot 9, again with a common Venturi impingement tray scrubber. As an aside here, Williamsburg, a couple years ago, converted to the zero hearth afterburner arrangement. And just as an aside, this is a very popular conversion that's been done now across the country, either single or double zero hearth conversions. Atlanta, Hartford, Buffalo, Detroit, St. Louis. Central Contra Costa Sanitary District in California, they have a zero hearth furnace afterburner arrangement. It was built 35 years ago, and what we've found in emission research that these zero hearth afterburner arrangements are more effective and efficient than the so-called detached afterburners. And we're suspecting, because EPA is going to review this rule in 5 years, and the initial limit on carbon monoxide is very high, very generous, 3,800 parts per million. We think they're going to drop that down maybe to the range of 500 parts per million. If that comes about, Williamsburg can comply with the way they sit, and you could still convert like Boat Harbor here to a zero hearth on top, which they did experiment with some in the past. Over at the VIP plant, it'd be a double zero hearth arrangement that would work well over there, and they also had tried a zero hearth in the past, and I think Ken Sands Crystal told me that when they did have it running here with a zero hearth, it did work pretty well. So anyway, that may be down the road. We generally like to remind ourselves that when we're talking about the wet feed rate, that it does include not just the water part, but the dry volatiles and the inerts. I think, as you all know, we're now regulated on the dry tons per day under the new rule. And we also sometimes like to look at what we call the water to volatile ratio, because that's an indication of how much auxiliary fuel we might need to supplement the process. The higher this number, of course, the more fuel you would need. The lower the number, the less fuel you would need. And what we have found in physical operations, if you're hit around a water to volatile ratio of 4 or less, and you don't have to afterburn, and if you don't have to now maintain any minimum temperatures, you can generally run with no fuel. Over at the VIP plant, these kind of cake solids condition, Riley and company have been able to run for days without fuel. I'm not sure that's going to be possible anymore with the new requirements. And again, just for general information purposes, the volatile solids, this is a typical composition of the elemental composition of the sludge cake. We get most of the energy from the carbon and the hydrogen fractions. And then I think you're mostly familiar, all familiar with the drying, burning, and cooling zones. And when the 503 hydrocarbon rule came into play 20-some years or so ago, we used to burn lower in these furnaces, but the requirement to maintain a higher exit temperature on top to comply with the hydrocarbon rule, everybody now is tending to run up on hearth 2, 3, or 4, and nobody's running down low anymore. So we generally see 3 or 4 hearths for the drying zone. Then, as you know, once the sludge starts burning, it's generally the combustion is completed over a hearth or hearth and a half. It's not stretched out like over 3 hearths, and so generally the combustion zone's a couple of hearths. The new rule talks about residence time with respect to new startup and shutdown procedures, and this busy chart is an attempt to give us some idea of what the residence times are in our furnaces. Here we're assuming that most of them have forearms on the top 3 drying hearths with a back rabble arrangement on one arm to affect better distribution and turnover. We'll be coming back to this chart later when we talk about the new rule requirements on startup and shutdown, but this is an approximate estimate. And then typically with these small hearth furnaces, once we get the sludge to the point it's ready to burn, we go down to 2 arms to slow down the turnover rate and allow more complete combustion. Here again, just a general representation of how the sludge and the gas temperatures inside the furnace tend to go. And we surmise that when the sludge reaches a cake solids level of about 65-70% solids, it's ready to ignite and burn. And of course, as we know, the hot gas going out through the top helps evaporate the water, and the air coming in the bottom cooling the ash and picking up heat to eventually let the burner help a maximum burn zone temperature. This chart I'd like to put, and I say this in a friendly way, we'd like to put this in the blood veins of all the regulators to remind them that we're at the mercy in these furnaces of the feed rate, amount, and quality coming in. The rules are not always sensitive to this factor because they're wanting us to meet instantaneous limits. And as you all know, here most of the sludge and some plants, it's 100% of the energy is from the sludge itself. And it's not that we're throwing this material in the furnaces and the burners are burning it up. As you all know, if we run the furnaces, any change in the feed rate ricochets through the equipment and it takes some time. And this basic physical reality affects these new rules with regard to startup and shutdown requirements, and we'll talk about that later. Capacity, as I understand, none of your facilities are at the capacity operating at the feed rates that you'd be at your shell capacity, so we won't beat this up a little bit, but again, just to be loyal to covering the subject, the capacity these furnaces are drying rate limited depending on cake solids and eventually can be heat release rate limited if you have real dry hot sludges. And we have found in physical, it's not textbook, but physical factors that affect the limits in terms of how much water evaporation rate we can get per hearth area that we're drying on, as well as heat release rate limits. We'll show you a heat release rate in limited furnace later, but anyway, when it gets around 20,000 BTUs per cubic foot an hour, it gets pretty hot. For example, here for Boat Harbor and VIP, this is sort of the stay out of trouble feed rate guidelines. If there's some facilities out there that are still running at near shell capacity and they have to respect these guidelines operationally. But what happens is, as you can see during the lower cake solids range, your drying rate limited, then you reach a point where you have to bring down the wet ton feed rate because you end up meeting a maximum dry tons per hour. And for these furnaces, the actual maximum is around 1.8, 1.9 dry volatile tons an hour. When you get to that point, you're going to see high temperatures, and in those operations, we expect safety and other factors. You can't exceed these limits, and we'll show you a furnace later that did this for 6 months and what the outcome was, but by burning more fuel, have high temperatures, tendon slagging, and so forth. And so, in particular with the drier sludges and the burnout conditions, and these are harder to operate. Some of the emission controls and concerns more of interest here to get requalified. We always try to keep this picture in mind that we affect afterburning in the top hearth and detached afterburners or zero hearth afterburners like Williamsburg to take care of the hydrocarbons, the old DOCs and furans, and even some of the visible yellow causing compounds we'll talk about later. Then we rely on the scrubber to take care of getting the water out, particulates, metals, acid gases, and we don't have necessarily a lot of operating magic to take care of those, and we rely on the scrubber to do that job. Then over here too, the hydrocarbon part of the emissions is a very small amount, and we found out thanks to a water environment research project 20 years ago that, for example, when you're running at the limit of 100 parts per million, it's almost all unburned methane and ethane. There's very little trace organics of kind of toxic compounds like benzene and acrylonitrile, toluene, stuff like that. So at that level, nobody's getting hurt. And that research also showed there were no real serious health effects from what we were putting out. I think you folks have seen this chart before, just showing how the top hearth exit temperature affects or afterburner temperature affects the different gaseous emissions, hydrocarbon, CO coming down. Particular interest is NO2, fraction of the total NOx, has a characteristic yellow color, and it's part of the yellow plume problem, and it comes down with temperature. Hydrocarbons, again, you've been dealing with this for a long time. As most of you know, it's pretty well controlled, but there are times when you're running along, life seems to be good, and you have little tantrums occur, and generally that's caused by maybe a cake feed rate or quality change that has moved the burn zone to a place and you have a temporary condition where the oxygen is coming down or the top of our temperatures drop. And while we generally say, look, don't overreact to it, don't do any major process change to take care of it, even if it's up, yeah, it bothers us, you see 300 or 400 parts per million, but you got plenty of time to take care of it. The rules, you know, is a monthly hourly average. You got to be over 100 parts per million for the whole month. So you got plenty of time to take care of it. Check out, check inside, see what's going on. You probably got a temperature problem on top or an oxygen condition. Take care of both of them and you can arrest these things generally in 15 or 20 minutes. Here again is another, just a characteristic look at how we all know that the hydrocarbons are affected by the top hearth or afterburner temperature. Unfortunately, as we'll talk about in a minute here too, the EPA and the current rule is not respecting that we'd still have afterburning going on in the large volume of these top hearths of the furnaces. That volume and the volume of your off-gas duct, all the emission research says that you really need to know what your top hearth temperature is, more so than the combustion zone temperature. The yellow, this has plagued the Malbahar sludge furnaces for years, and thanks again to the Water Environment Research Project 20 years ago, we were able to get some high-powered combustion chemists involved to help us find out what this stuff was, because we were being fooled by different things. And what that research found is what the chemists call nitrogenated organics, which is, they say, is because our source, they consider burning a high nitrogen waste, and the loosely bound nitrogen in sludge combines with oxygen in the combustion zone and makes NO2, and then the NO2, and from their point of view, when it reaches the top part of the furnace, the so-called cooling zones, even though it might be 900,000 degrees, forms these nitrogenated organics, and they told us that these compounds, number one, were thermally stable, that once you form them, you gotta get some temperature in there in afterburn to knock them down and thermally destruct them. They also said they were semi-polar, had a little bit of electrical charge, which explained a mystery we saw early where we could see, even in a particulate test, see filters come out yellow, where you have a yellow cast to the particulate. And what's happening, these semi-polar compounds are attaching to fine particulates, because then we were not sure whether it's particulates or what. And the treatment for it is, I think you all know now too, is that we're trying to reduce the oxygen level in the body of the furnace to reduce the amount of NOx we form. Then whatever amount we form, we try to knock it down by reducing the, increasing the top hard temperature to thermally destruct the amount that's formed. So depending on the facility and what's going on, generally we say 1,000 degrees or more, and particularly it's sensitive to oxygen, that if you called over and said, look, it looks real bad today, the oxygen level is probably above 6-7% wet. If you were at that level and you had a low exit temperature, you probably got a lot of visible yellow. So one of the first things you would do to help reduce it is look at your oxygen level, and you may have some limits on what you need to do on the top hard temperature. Speaking of NOx, this is a characteristic profile that we've seen in furnaces now all around the country on NOx. As you know, the NOx is primarily controlled by the oxygen level. And what we're seeing, that, and I think you've all seen it here in Hampton Roads, that need to get down in this 4-5% wet oxygen range to meet this new limit on NOx of 220 parts per million. Curious enough, we're seeing it in other furnaces. If we're up around 6 or 6.5, we're over the limit, and if we get down below 5, and particularly in 4 and 4.5 range, life is a lot better. Carbon monoxide. Here, the reason I'm showing this chart, this is hard to read up here, but this was done for the Michigan DEQ some years back. We took 147 tests from 24 test series, including some from the US EPA, across 21 different furnaces. So in spite of that being across all these furnaces, different sizes, different feed rates, oxygen levels, all the rest, the persistence of the top hearth exit temperature, this is a very highly correlated statistical curve with even with all that variety. And if we took any of your plants and you looked at your CO profile with temperature, it'd be a lot more higher correlated, like shown by this chart, which is a plant in Concord, North Carolina, that had a CO monitor continuously monitoring what's going on. Unfortunately, the EPA hasn't taken time, let me pause here for a comment, in writing these new rules to look at, number one, the emission research history, the regulatory permitting history. Always historically, in most states, they didn't care what your burn zone temperature was, but they held us to a minimum hearth one exit temperature because it dictates CO levels, hydrocarbons, and many other things. Even if they had taken time just to look at all the hydrocarbon data that's been collected for 20 years over all these facilities, that would have told them that it would be more important to control us to the exit temperature and not to a burn zone temperature, as you all know, is becoming a little complicated, and hopefully they'll reconsider. We'll talk about that some more later. So in summary, like taking a driver's test or trying to remember something, this chart tries to try to summarize who controls what, you know, the wet scrubber taking care of the particulates, the metals, sulfur dioxide, and the hydrogen chloride. Didn't have enough room for all these things. Carbon monoxide, hydrocarbons, dioxin, furans, and visible yellow affected by the hearth one or afterburner temperature. And to have the hearth one temperature goes up afterburner, you get a slight bump in the NOx, but it's really the oxygen level that's the primary thing to reduce the NOx, and of course, as we've talked about with the visible yellow. But on the test, we ask these kind of questions because the guys are now running these compliance tests, and knowing what controls what is important, because once you're in there in the throes of the middle of a testing, And the stack tester tells you you're over the limit on one of these things. It's important to know what to do about it. So the new, again, the new regulated pollutants are here. Same reason we need to be familiar with what these are. Tests ask you questions and name some of them, and you should be able to do so. This is a busy summary chart of all the requirements of the new rule. We're not going to beat ourselves up on trying to test you or ask you about specific limits on the pollutants, but we do want to concentrate, as you all know now, on the operating limits that you got to maintain in routine operation. This is kind of a summary of your common permit conditions with the opacity limits and, of course, the new emission limits by test. And as we talked about this chamber burn zone temperature, EPA has doubled down on this. They're just 3 months ago, they published what they call the federal implementation plan for this rule. And part of the public comment, somebody said, hey, why are you looking at the burn zone temperature? Why don't you look at the top part temperature? EPA said, thank you very much, but we don't trust what the temperature is in the top part, and we still want you to do the burn zone stuff. Well, there again, As I said earlier, they haven't looked at the physical history because the regulatory permitting history and the science, if you will, all says, I don't care what your combustion zone temperature, if I'm regulating you, just tell me what your top part temperature is and I'll tell you what your CO number is. Matter of fact, we came close 20 some years ago to avoid putting hydrocarbon monitors in. We proposed that each plant run a temperature performance test to find out which exit temperature they would maintain 100 parts per million and they would run to that temperature for the rest of their operating life. And we would have been able to replace a $250,000 hydrocarbon monitoring system with a thermocouple. Because you can look at the top of our temperature and pretty well predict, as you've probably seen, what your hydrocarbon level is. Now in your case, and be careful what I say here, but in your case, the Virginia DEQ has historically regulated and pinned you down on the pressure drops, like for example in your Venturi and also your Trace scrubber. They've pinned you down on water flows, like here at Boat Harbor, the multiple water flows and sections of your scrubber. Crystal, you got all these different minimums to meet. If you go outside of Virginia, New York, Michigan, Pennsylvania, Indiana, Missouri, where a lot of the furnaces are, all we're looking at and all the regulators are asking for is total scrubber water flow, total scrubber pressure drop, which is a lot easier to deal with because, as I think you've already run into, for example, having a limit on the impingement trace scrubber in the Venturi section. Yeah, you go off, you run the test, you're running at a pretty higher feed rate. Everybody goes home, you come in the next day, you're back at normal feed rates, and all of a sudden the pressure drop across the impingement trace scrubber is below your limit, and you have to artificially add more air and run more draft through the furnace to get the pressure drop up. Whereas if you were regulated like the rest of the world is, on total pressure drop, you can take care of it by tightening up the Venturi scrubber. And I've been pushing on Mark Feltner to keep trying to push back to get that change. Perhaps maybe after you send enough deviation reports in, we may have let them check what, and because it's a physical circumstance. But their response is, they say, well, the rule says each scrubber. They're defining each section of your whole scrubber system as a scrubber. Anyway, enough of the venting, I guess I should say, but having worked side by side with many of you and others in the country, this is a reality and we're in there trying to operate and comply, and yet the rules are not sensitive to our physical realities and we're not trying to evade the rule, but it ought to make more sense. But this has historically been the case, and even before these rules, we were regulated on total pressure drop and total water flow. Scrubber outlet pH, not one of my most favorite subjects, or Riley's, I don't think either, right? But anyway, here EPA is using a scrubber outlet pH, which we've never measured before in the malt hearth industry, as a surrogate measure of your compliance with the acid gas limits, that when you're running your compliance test during the SO2 runs and the hydrogen chloride runs, whatever your minimum, as you know, 1 hour pH level is, then that's the one that you now have to maintain on a 3 hour block average. Now, I don't know where the 3 hours come from, because in some furnaces it's 3 hours from top to bottom. What we think is going on here is EPA, because we have no information historically on our industry, they've adopted the rule from some other source category. So, well, since we don't have anything, let's let them try that. So I don't know why they didn't set this at 12 hours point. And of course, on the ash system, visible emissions, anything over 3 minutes an hour is considered a deviation. Now, the hydrocarbon rule, the subpart 503 hydrocarbon limit is still with us. The new rule did not eliminate that. Maximum combustion zone temperature, 24-hour average, that's not a problem for any of you that I know. It's still with us, so, because the 503 rule, as you know, came under the Clean Water Act, and the MAC emissions is under the Clean Air Act. So anyway, we thought they would probably get rid of that, but they didn't. The mercury limit that you still have here is the new limit on emissions is a lot more stringent than that, and this is by test, I think, every 5 years. Here, again, we've already talked about the operating parameter limits, but I think just to keep things separate here, the operating limits have to do with these four conditions, and you have to meet those limits anytime you got sludge in the furnace. When there's no sludge in the furnace, you're on warm standby, or you're warming up, you don't have to meet these four operating mode conditions. But the rule also says, because it confused some of us in the beginning, says here that the rule calls that you meet all the pollutant emission limits all the time, even during malfunction. We'll get to that. Now, what we found just 3 months ago, published by EPA and their response to comments, because most of our facilities around the country, I don't know what your past practice has been here, that when we were warming up the furnace or we put it on warm standby, we'd open the, shut the ID fan off and the scrubber off and run it out through the bypass. EPA is now saying right here that no, we don't intend for you to do that at any time, even if there's no sludge being burned. So what they're saying is that now when you're warming the furnace up or you're on warm standby, you've got to go out through the scrubber and ID fan. Okay. What they're also saying here in the positive sense, that you're not, since we're only burning natural gas, we're not putting any pollutants out, so we're meeting the pollutant limits if we got the ID fan and the scrubber on. But anyway, there are facilities out, I know there's agencies out there that don't know that that's what EPA's intent is here, and this was just 3 months ago. So, in summary here, again, operating limits, when you got sludge in the furnace, you gotta maintain them, but when you are out of service, warm standby, or when you're just starting up, because their definition of shutdown and startup, and we kind of need to review this again here, I get, like I just said, that the operating limits comply when there's sludge in the furnace, and they're talking about actually or a period after you cut it off after a period of residence time, which we'll comment on here in a minute. Shutdown, meaning the period of time after you've, all the sludge has been combusted in a primary chamber. Now here, they're trying to talk about fluid bed furnaces and malt bars at the same time. In our case, we're burning on hearth 2, 3, or 4, depending on which plant you're at. That's our primary chamber. So once you burn that out, across those hearths, you're essentially out of service and shut down according to the rule. On startup, they're saying that startup period has to include the time that you initially even fire a burner when you're warming up to the time that you start feeding the furnace. Now during that time, you would be going still out through the scrubber and the ID fan and be meeting the emission limits, but not have to meet the operating limits. When we first read this stuff, said, oh my goodness, we can't meet this pressure drop and all this other stuff when we start up. Matter of fact, it's still a problem. I don't know what you guys have been running into since you've been complying, but some of these furnaces out there are running 15,000 to 30,000 wet pounds an hour. When they go to start them up, they start with like 7,000 or 8,000 pounds, 4 tons, to kind of bed it in, get things going, and then they walk it up. And it can be 6 hours before we get to the target production feed rate. Again, remember the chart before where it says, look, our fuel, our energy is all in the sludge. The rules don't respect that. They're insensitive to the fact, takes time. So what other agencies are looking at doing is they're saying, okay, it takes me 6 hours to start from the start of feed to get to a full loaded condition. They're putting it in their procedure. And they're saying, well, okay, we're not trying to evade the rule here, Mr. Inspector, but this is our physical reality, and come down and take a look. The rule is not sensitive to this. So they're putting it in their procedure. They're saying to their SCADA system, okay, we're going to start feeding 6 hours later. You can start the regulatory clock and start monitoring pressure drop, scrubber water flow, temperatures, and so forth. In between that time, we're not going to count it. Okay? Now, also on shutdown, the same thing there, where, like we talked about earlier, this residence time chart. So you've got a feel on each of your furnaces at the time you shut the feed off, how much time later you're burned out. In a sense that 85, 90 minutes, whatever. Even if you make it 100, make it sure. And you put that in your procedure. Now you're telling the SCADA system, look, okay, I just shut off the feed. Start the clock 90 minutes later or whatever the time constant is for your furnace. I'm out of service. Do not count and monitor pressure drop, scrubber water flow, and all the rest, because we're out of service and we're shut down by definition of the rule. I think we've got that in some of your procedures already. I think about 90 minutes for VIP, but this is something that, again, if it was questioned by the state, and matter of fact, I've had discussions directly with inspectors in New York and Missouri and Michigan, and when we described this to them, the state inspectors, now they say, yeah, that all makes sense and it's reasonable. So I think, work with Mark Feldner, you can get that sort of established, because they could always come down and find out that the rule wasn't sensitive to our physical realities, because it takes its time to come up and come down. Let me stop here for a minute. Any questions about any of that? Because it does affect what you guys are doing when you're sitting in the chair every day, of whether you're complying or not, and we all don't want to have any deviations. Malfunction. Now, help me out here, guys. Last time I checked, our malfunctions, lose the ID fan, burner air fan, cooling air fan, loss of scrubber water, the emergency bypass damper is going to open. Once it's open, we're in deviation of the pollutant emission limits anyway. So the operating limits things are sort of preempted by that. Because like they said, any opening, and I understand you guys have been afflicted with power bumps popping your bypass damper. And didn't you used to have a time condition on that, Crystal, where 10 minutes or something? And maybe, you know, after EPA sees all these routine nuisance emissions, deviations anyway, that you can't do anything about anyway, though maybe give you a little break and give you a little time to reduce the reporting. Now, there is one failure, like if the center drive motor heats up and gives it up. If that stops, the emergency bypass damper doesn't open. Now you still got the fan running, the main gas valve still on, you still got burners, scrubber. Okay, yeah, you go out there and see where the shaft stopped at, make sure none of the burners are impinging on any of the rabble arms, use those that are in a safer location, and you should be able to use those burners you can use to take the furnace out of service and still maintain and meet your operating limits. Does anybody here know of any other malfunction beyond the ones we mentioned here. I think this is pretty well covered. So this malfunction thing, which we said good luck on that, we really can't do much about when we have a malfunction. So again, why we're here too, this certified operator requirement. And in the state of Virginia added this requirement, you have a minimum of 1 year. Now Mark Feltner just recently talked to me about this, that the state of Virginia now is sort of bowed out of this business of having to approve all these programs and stuff that can be done in-house like we've done here. Mark Feltner's observation is this is not in the MAC rule, which it is not. Matter of fact, they should have given some consideration if you'd had so many years of operating experience that would qualify you as a certified operator. So even if, has anybody here has been here less than a year? But but for the record, you're going to be asked on the cover of the test sheet to record your years of experience. Mark Feltner is not concerned about it. He said because the program meets the requirements of the rule and the state is sort of backed away from that. But if you had read it in the reference document, all the rest, I just wanted to make it clear. The other part of this, the other question that's always been asked, do you have to be a certified operator to run the equipment? The answer is no. What the rule says that if you've attended a session such as this, and that's why the attendance sheet is an official record, and you have been exposed to the material like in the technical reference document, and you're so-called familiar with equipment, if all that's happened within the 12 months, then you can run the furnace if there's a certified operator, which would be at the facility or near the facility. This would apply, for example, new operators or whatever who hadn't actually went through the program. The other good news here is that once you pass the certification test, like hopefully you all will do today, you don't have to take it again. A year from now, August 1st, 2017, they tell you to get together, review the update of the regulations, other things with respect to operations, startup, and so forth, and discuss any of the problems you've been encountered and improve what's going on. Let me stop there. Any questions?